Welcome to the history. Welcome to the culture. Welcome to community that dreams and achieves. Living in change for better tomorrow. Welcome to the Eunice Malat Show.
Welcome to the Eunice Malat Show. We have another great show planned up for you today. So, have you ever thought about being an actress, performing in stage in front of a lot of people, expressing yourself and the audience delighting in your self-expression? Today we have a guest with us, an actress by the name of Chewuda Chwol, who came all the way from Melbourne, Australia. And we're so happy to have her on the show today. Welcome to the program.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
Oh, it's wonderful to have you here. So you're from Australia. What part of Australia are you from?
I'm from Melbourne, Australia. Uh-huh. For the last 2 years, I've been living on the Gold Coast, studying acting.
Oh, excellent.
At the New York Film Academy.
At the New York Film Academy, here in the US.
No, it's a US. It's a U.S. university, but they have a campus in Australia, so I've been attending that one.
Oh, wow. And so you've been acting there, actually training to be an actress and stuff.
Yes.
Oh, for 2 years.
It's very intense, yes, for 2 years. It's really, like, I know people say you can't study acting, but I used to say that until I attended the New York Film Academy, and I was like, wow, so I can actually learn something from acting.
Yeah, absolutely. So what drew you into acting?
I have a, like, in me, I have a desire to want to be so many things. Like, I went through university, I keep changing my courses because I couldn't decide what I want to be because I have a fascination. I want to learn everything about everything. So my mom was like, you need to stop doing this. So I was like, well, if I become an actress, then every movie I can do different things.
Play different roles.
Exactly. I can, every time I can be like a pilot, I can be a doctor, I can be a military base person, I can be a nurse, I can help people, I can change the world somehow in telling stories. And I believe as an actor, I have the power to influence what people think and how to, and I can educate people about human nature, the cultures and everything. So acting is, that's what drew me to acting. It's basically just to make a difference somehow and live 1,000 lives.
Yeah. So where are you originally from?
I'm from South Sudan, the youngest country in the world.
Yes.
And yeah. Yeah, that's where I'm from, South Sudan.
Oh, okay. So when did you migrate to Australia?
I came to Australia, I went to Australia in 2004, October, near the end of the year. And I went with my auntie, which was with my mom at the time. I'm not sure, yeah, because when I was a little kid, there's a war that broke out in Sudan.
Yes.
And I lost my dad. And my mom went with my other siblings. And so we kind of like, I was lost, we were split.
Yes.
And since I was 6 years old, my aunt did not want to tell me that she wasn't my mom. So she took me in and raised me as an own daughter.
Wow.
So yeah, and in 2004, me and her, we came to Australia together as
one family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. So all along you thought that she was your real mother.
Yeah.
But in actuality, she is your aunt.
My auntie, yeah.
Is she your mom's sister or your dad's sister?
She's my mom's sister.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. And she raised you as her own kid.
Yeah. She raised me pretty much. It's good. It's amazing. She raised me as her own child.
Yeah. At what point did she tell you that she's your aunt, and what made her tell you that?
In 2007, my mom was in a refugee camp in Kakuma. Mm-hmm. And so my auntie came up to me. She's like, here's the good news and the bad news. The bad news is, well, I'm not really your mother. I'm your auntie. And the good news is they found your birth mother. And, you know, I was kind of like, oh, really? So given this new information, I reached out to the Australian government and I did a DNA test with my mother. And it turned out she was really my mom. So DNA confirmed it, and I put in a permanent visa. Mm-hmm. And within a year or so, my mother arrived in Australia. Wow. And I got to meet her.
Really?
So by 2009, she was in Australia.
So it was such a short period of time. By the time you found out who your real mother was, and by the time she came to Australia and you guys reunited, it was everything happened so fast.
Yeah,
most people are not fortunate to have that. So it's a blessing.
It is a blessing. I was like, wow. So I inherited a whole new family.
Yeah.
And I had like five new siblings.
Wow.
And my auntie had like kids of her own that were my brothers and sisters. So every time I talk about my mom, everyone's like, which are you talking about? Because I call them both mom, and I call this one my sibling. So it's kind of like,
And what was that like, being introduced to your mom for the first time and establishing a relationship with her?
It was good. I found out a lot about myself. I found out like she was very like understanding about everything. She was like, yeah, you know, you want to be an actor, go for it. So when I say my mom is like, and people get confused, and like my mom say to them, it's like, but usually it's my both my mom and my auntie.
Yes.
So I just call them both mom. But it was really, really amazing. Like I found out so much about myself, and I get to find out a lot of things.
Mm-hmm. About your history and your background.
And my dad and all this stuff. And I got to know a lot of people from my dad's side of the family, so they lived in Melbourne. So they're like, oh yeah, I'm your auntie, and they used to introduce themselves, and it was really good.
And establishing a relationship with your siblings, the new siblings that you had now, what was that like?
Surprisingly, it was amazing. Like they were so excited that they had this older sister somewhere else. My brother was so relieved that he wasn't the oldest anymore.
I know, because within the South Sudanese culture, it's like if you're the oldest, all responsibilities primarily falls on your shoulder,
and
right?
You get blamed for everything, or you just you have to, because you're the oldest child, you have to just
set a good example
and just set an example for the family. So I was like, well, now I have like a ease that, you know, I'm the oldest, so I can mess around and be a child again.
Exactly. Right. Absolutely. So, I know if you do anything wrong, they're like, you shouldn't have done that, you know? Your little brothers and sisters are watching your actions.
They're all looking up to you when you do this. So I was just like, yep. Yeah. Don't worry, all the roles can go to me. So I'm excited about that.
Oh, very nice, very nice. So when did you come to the U.S.?
I came to the U.S. on the 15th of August. 15th of June. 15th is when I'm leaving. 15th of June. You guys are kind of behind. Yeah. So 15th of June.
Oh, so what brought you here?
It's a scholarship that I told you about from the New York Film Academy. So I went there and took a couple of classes for 3 weeks, and I got to meet with industry people and just have a talk, and they get to educate me about the industry and how everything works. And it's just like, it's so different to the Australian industry, because it's just like, if you meet like, I don't explain it. I just found it like it's a whole lot easier here, or like harder in a sense somehow. So it's just like everything is so condensed, but it's like moving, you know, we're actors, you know, this. So it's like they introduced me into so many things. I'm just like, that makes me want to be just an actor so much more, like learning it from Los Angeles, which is basically Hollywood based, which is where all the acting comes from, the filmmakers and everything. So it's just like, it was really inspiring.
So they had like the workshop there, and you met industry. Who are some of the people that some of us might know who are not in the industry that you were able to meet?
Well, actually, I think I met more like industry people, because like, a lot of the teachers at the New York Film Academy, they're all like industry-based actors. They're still working like in the industry, and they're still like, they're either like managers or agents or actors or filmmakers that have just decided to take a break, but they still go to auditions from time to time, and they work in the industry. It makes it so much easier to, like, you know, define what you want to do, rather than saying, oh, well, I'm not really sure, I'm just doing it to pass time.
Yeah.
You know, but it's like, nope, I definitely want to do this. I definitely want to be an actor.
Yeah, people have the perception that acting is such an easy thing, you know, so you don't have to even memorize lines, you can improvise, you know, and you can shed tears very easily. I mean, it doesn't require a lot of effort, you know, but it requires really a lot of critical thinking and training to be an expert at it.
It's a very, very extensive process. Like, it's really hard, because like I used to think it was easy, I can just draw emotions, but it's very, very exhausting. Like, because the fact that you can go through like so many emotions in one day, or in one scene, or in something, because you can laugh, then you can cry, and then you're depressed, and then you're this, and then you're that, all within the 1 hour of like being in a, you know, being in a scene. And it's just so emotionally exhausting. Mm-hmm. And I did not know how much until I went to New York Film Academy, mm-hmm. where we have things like the psychology of acting, which you went to go through all the emotions. So that class was emotionally draining. The first day we went there, it's like the very first class, we had to do laugh out of nowhere, cry out of, find something that makes you cry out of nowhere. It's just like, how do I cry? And my teacher was like, you know, find an emotion that made you cry once upon a time. What is it, a dream, anything that makes you sad? And you're just like, how do I draw that? Why would I want to do that to myself? But I think that's the beauty of being an actor, is being able to, you know, draw all those emotions and be completely naked in front of an audience and just bare yourself. And then as soon as you're finished, you know, just smile and say, oh, wait, I've done my job.
Yeah,
but it's not that easy.
Yeah, it's like you're manipulating your mind, you know, to think a certain way. And as your teacher was saying, where did you go? Where deep inside yourself did you try to seek out that sense of, you know, I need to laugh, or, you know, feelings of, okay, I need to cry?
Yeah.
You know, so for the aspect of laughing, what came to your mind?
The laughing.
Yeah.
When I was in Kenya, we had, with my siblings and my cousins and everyone, because in Africa, you know, we live, as Africans, we always have like a lot of kids in one house, and there's a lot of us. So back then, back in 2003, I think, before we came to Australia, there was this monkey next door that we had as a, I don't know, our next door neighbor had a monkey.
Yeah.
But the monkey keeps visits our house every day. And every time he gave us a visit, uh-huh. the guy next door told us that do not feed that monkey. But because we're kids, we didn't listen.
Yeah.
So one day we didn't have a banana for the monkey.
Uh-huh.
And the monkey kind of just like beats everyone in the house with a stick because he got so mad that we didn't give it bananas. So every time I want to laugh, I just go back to that time of just being so childish and just like, what the hell was I thinking when I did that?
Yeah.
So every time I just tell that story, it just makes me laugh because it just, I don't know, I
love
it.
Something humorous, absolutely.
Like, why would you ever do that? You know, like a monkey beating you, like,
exactly.
Like it hits you. It's a monkey, like why?
But, and then you can like have sound effects of music.
That makes me laugh. I just love it every time. Like,
very good. Yeah. Now, for the aspect of emotion, deep sadness, where were you able to draw your emotions from?
Well, we come from a very, very, well, we are in a very broken world. And it's not that hard to find sad emotions. You can look at a picture of someone that's, you know, in a prison, chained to something, and they're depressed, and they look dirty in the clothes they wear. That's sad to me, because I look at myself and I'm like, well, and I dress well and they don't dress well. That, you know, it's human nature to feel empathy for other people. And so if I just want to get deep into somewhere where I can personally connect to it, I can either go to a time where like I can draw something mm-hmm. out of that happens to me in the past, or I can just look at the world and see how it is. Example for Sudan especially, like if I look back at my country and I was like, all those millions of people that die every day, that don't have enough food, that die of war, the innocent people that, you know, they're being killed, like that makes me sad. And just if I just breathe a few times, you know, just like let it all in, just imagine you're there, just imagine that person is your brother or your sister, or that person like being cut in half, if that was my mother, what would happen? And just use that imagination, just keep thinking over again, just have a look at that picture and just look at it, just keep thinking it's your mom, mm-hmm. and emotions will draw, because if you keep thinking that's your mother, then what will you do? Because mm-hmm. people just look at things like, oh well, it doesn't affect me because they're somebody else.
Yeah, they detach themselves from the situation.
You detach yourself, you know, exactly.
And say, well, it's happening all the way in Africa Asia.
It doesn't
affect
me.
You know, it doesn't concern me.
Exactly, but mm-hmm. as an actor, it's part of that is to be connected with the entire world. The good, the bad, and the ugly, I have to be connected to that. Mm-hmm. I have to carry all that burden with me and take it around everywhere I go, because mm-hmm. I can only draw it every time that I need it. If I have a scene which makes me sad, I can do that. Or if I see like a nice picture of African kids playing in the dirt and they're so happy, that makes me happy, because it's like they have nothing, but yet they have everything and they're so happy about it.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Very good, very good. Now, as an actress, you know, we have to put you on spot, you know?
What are you talking about?
Oh, we have to put you on spot.
Okay.
So, could you perform for us one of your monologues?
I can try.
Okay. The stage is yours.
If the emotions don't come,
That's okay.
Mm-hmm. I'll just take a few seconds, if that's okay with you.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. She's going to take a few seconds here, gather her thoughts.
What? Lisa, do you remember all those times that you would go to the museum on the weekends with mother? And I would be left at home and she would say that I was being punished for whatever? No, you're gonna sit right there and you're gonna listen. Lisa, see, one day I heard your dad and mama arguing about me. I mean, you were too young to remember this, but he was going to leave. And I heard mama say, no, please, I'll do it. Please. I didn't know what she was talking about. And she came. She found me, put me in a bathtub. She combed my hair, put perfume on me, and she told me to just relax. Yes, it's true. And she let him come in and rape me. See, Mama, I have a man who wants to love me, and I won't let him because of you, because of what you did to me. I won't let you hold me down any longer. I'm gonna love hard, and I'm gonna be a better mother. And I pray that God have mercy on your soul.
Wow! Excellent! Excellent! Wow!
No.
That was great. You had me drawn to the whole monologue and to the emotion that you expressed. You're actually tearing up. Wow. You're a true actress. Oh,
thank you so much.
Oh, wow. That was amazing. That was really amazing. Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And I think, you know, when you talk and, you know, it's not only a form of just expressing the monologue, you become attached to it, the emotion of it, you know. And I think that's where you're drawing the emotions from.
Yeah, because you have to take yourself in. To that actor and into that character, and you have to be that person for the hour, however long it takes until that scene is over. I have to transform myself, you know, as an actor. You have to leave who you are outside the door as soon as you walk into a studio, and you have to just, you know, step into that person. It's like just changing clothes. It's like this person that I am, I have to just strip up this whole skin of mind plus emotions and just leave him there. It's like when you go to work and you wear your mechanic clothing and stuff like that, and you know, stuff like that. And I just walk in and I just step in and be that person for that long and just feel the emotions, feel the, you know, be them for a while and just get to know what it's like to be them,
absolutely.
You know, and take yourself out of your world for a second.
So are there any movies you've performed in at all?
No, I've been, because I've just graduated, so I haven't actually done a lot of, like, I haven't done any films big at the moment. Yeah. I've been doing a lot of extra stuff and stuff like that, so I've just been trying to get my foot to the door. So I've done a lot of, I've done extra works, you know, on films that are coming out soon. And
Very good. So now you're, when you go back to Australia, you're going to start auditioning for movies and everything? That
yes, I will start doing that as soon as I go to Australia and try to find, build as much credit as I can, and hopefully come back to the US within 2 years and start working here.
Oh yeah, with your talent, I'm sure it's not going to be hard at all.
So I'm hoping for that, you know, just to get there and get as much stuff out there as I possibly can. And because I write my own material and stuff like that, so I'll have to work as much hard on that as well.
So you write your own materials? Are you talking about scripts itself?
Yeah, like I write script and stuff like that because, you know, as an, if you're really serious about, you know, being an actress or, you know, just being a filmmaker in general and just making a difference in the world, you have to learn to write your own story. So I write my own stuff because I can't just sit around forever waiting for someone to write their own story so I can bring it to life.
So you're like a go-getter, you know?
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So I have to, you know, I'm just like, I'm going to write this. And like, I know I get lazy sometimes, but.
Yeah. If you don't mind me asking, how old are you?
I'm 23 years old.
You're 23 years old. Yeah. And you came all the way from Australia by yourself, pursuing your dreams.
Yeah, I came with a group of my friends that I studied with.
Yes.
There was 9 of us when we came, and they all went back. So I told them I'm going to go to the Midwest and visit my cousin.
Yeah, yeah. The thing is, it's amazing because people get so comfortable with their state of living and their state of life, you know, that they don't want to get out of the box, you know. For example, leave Omaha, you know, go to a different country, go to Europe, travel, you know, explore your dreams. And you are doing that. You're living your dreams, you know. And that's something that we all need to commend and all need to aspire to, you know. Wow, especially if we're also a South Sudanese and African girl.
It's really hard.
You know, it's really hard because we're raised in a culture whereby they're very protective of their girls.
Exactly, it's really
And they shelter you. They don't want you to be in front of the stage because it's like, you should remain pure, you know?
Yeah, as they say, remain pure. You're my little girl, don't ever go anywhere.
Exactly, you know? Go to school. Once you're done with school, go ahead and like get married.
Have a job and get married and have a couple of kids, you know? And being an actor is out of the ordinary. It's not a job.
Extraordinary.
To the African community, because to us, acting is not guaranteed. Because acting is not guaranteed.
It is not.
It's one of those jobs where you don't know what you're going to do tomorrow. You know, you do one film every once in a year and you're like, well, now I got to wait for the next film to come. And which is what promote, like, you know, got me into writing my own things. And because I had such amazing lecturers, they pushed me toward that because where I come from, you know, they're just like, you know, your country has so much story. You know, I know you need to do this and you can do this. And they pushed me so hard that I finally just said, I can accept this and I can do it. I know writing is not my strongest point, but I do write it. And they're like, just do it because you can do it. You know, just because you're not strong at something doesn't mean you can't do it. You know, just. And my teachers, they were so amazing. And I am so grateful for the New York Film Academy lecturers because they're just amazing.
Absolutely. So within the Australian community, what do you do there in Australia and stuff within the African community?
I'm a youth leader. So I do a lot of, I'm a multicultural youth leader. So it's not just the African or the Sudanese. I work with Iraqian youth, youth from Cambodia or like, it's mostly multicultural and Australian youth and stuff like that. And because Australia is such a multicultural country, it allows me to meet a lot of different people and from different backgrounds. And because I love my culture too much, I don't want anybody else to forget their culture. And that's the reason why I got into working with multicultural people, because I want people, I want like a bunch of kids in the room, like if there's about 12 children in the room, they're all from different backgrounds. I don't want them to want to adapt to somebody else's. I want them to be themselves, to be their culture, and at the same time come together the one, but not forget where you came from. And working with multicultural youth allowed me to do that. You know, we train kids and teach them to love who they are and where they came from, while still living in Australia and adopting the Australian culture, but bring your own culture with that.
And what prompted you to maintain such a strong stance on one preserving their own culture?
I don't know where that came from, really. I think I've always just been so content with who I am. I think it's just because throughout history or everything, we've just been taught to always like where you are, you know, you must change where you come from to fit in, like through high school. Like we all see this in high school, you lose yourself, especially because everyone is so obsessed about fitting into a group that you must lose yourself along the way for you to get into that group. And I think in society, we're so taught to do that. If you want to fit somewhere, you must change who you are.
Yeah, and there's a slogan that when in Rome, do as the Romans do.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's like, really?
So, yeah, there's that. And it's just like, and I'm just like, well, if different, because I met a lot of different people. And every time I hear their stories and everything, it just admire, like, I admire them so much that they still, like, you know, who they are. And I'm always like, yeah, I can be me, you know. Mm-hmm. Being me is just fine. And I think I've always been one of those kids that's just like a standout. I don't think I fit anywhere. Like in high school, I get along with I hang with the geeks and the, you know, the so-called, like people say, the geeks and the cool people or the cool kids and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, I've never really picked a group.
Yes.
I've always been like, I can hang with everybody. Mm-hmm. You know, I can have different sort of friends.
You're your own friend.
Exactly.
You know, your best friend is you.
Exactly.
And when you establish that, it's like everything else is secondary.
Everything else kind of just feels in between. It's like, if I go to this group, I can hang with them. And I go to these people, I can, you know, mm-hmm. still be with them without having to be like changing who I am. And which is why you get meet a lot of people and you have so many friends, because you're not trying to change them and they're not trying to change you. Or even if they try, you say, mm-hmm. no, this mm-hmm. is who I am. You must accept me as this. And, you know, people respect that. People respect it when you stand up and say, this is me, you know, love me or hate me sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So it's like.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, that's interesting, because how can you bring the aspect of your culture and into acting itself?
Can I do that? Okay, well, because...
Or do you feel like being from different cultures, because you're from Africa,
yeah,
and also you have learned the Australian culture, I mean, and then within the African culture, there are different, you know, sub-tribes that practice different, you know, traditions and
yeah.
stuff. So it's like your way of thinking is on so many levels. How does that make you unique compared to just an actress from, or an actor from the US or Australia?
Well, I would say that makes me unique, but like I keep, everyone is unique in their own way. But I'm unique because I'm African. I know the African culture. I know the Sudanese culture. I know how, you know, people think, and I know how they act around things, and I know how they do certain things. But then I've been in Australia for 10 years, for almost 10 years, and I've learned that culture, and I've also, you know, learned so many different aspects. So as an actor, if I was to bring into any of that, I would easily relate to more characters than most actors will have to struggle to go through, because I'll be like, well, I know how to do that. You know, a character from Africa or somewhere in Africa, I can relate to that because I am African. But if they're in Australia and they're like a character that's lost in Australia because they don't know who they are, I can know that because I've been through that. I've been into that culture where I kind of got confused because there were so many cultures around me. Like, you almost lose yourself in that because you don't know what to do anymore. Mm-hmm. It's like, yeah. So I think that makes me unique as a storyteller, because I know so much.
Thank you.
Much.
Yes, thank you. And we thank you for tuning in on the program here at the Eunice Mallah Show. We look forward to seeing you next week.
If you believe, you can achieve.